Good morning. This week, we are going through Paul's financial advice to Timothy, in which he urges Timothy to focus on cultivating contentment rather than pursuing financial gain. Contentment is superior because when you're contented, you have already achieved what discontented people hope to but can never accomplish in their quest for financial gain. Yesterday, we looked at the first step that Paul recommends for developing a contented heart, which is to practice the spiritual discipline of simplicity. The next thing Paul says we need to do is to free ourselves from the love of money. It is not enough to take practical steps to live a simple lifestyle. We must also recalibrate the inclination of our heart. Most of us have a desire to make lots of money. We want to admit it, of course, because we don't want to appear shallow, but it is not difficult to expose our lie. Let me ask you this, if you are a student, what is one major factor, if not the main factor, influencing the course you want to study? It's often about how much money you think you'll be able to make in future, isn't it? So you do love money. It's the same for working adults. What influences your choice of a job or of moving to a new job? Isn't a big part of it about money? Yes, of course. Again, you may not admit it or be aware of it, but I have a special vantage point to witness this time and again. You see, part of my job is to recruit people into full-time ministry or to the mission field. And I can tell you, without a doubt, the number one impediment to people serving God full-time is not ability, but money. Whatever reasons they may give, most people are simply not willing to give up the opportunity to make a lot more money in the marketplace. I'm not recruiting at the moment, so this is not to guilt trip anyone into coming on board. It's just to help you realize that most of us do, in fact, love money. On the face of it, the love of money seems shallow but harmless. It may not sound noble, but we don't think there's anything wrong with it either. However, the Bible warns us that this is not so. 1 Timothy chapter 6 verses 9 to 10 says, "Those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs." Here Paul warns us about three hazards that the love of money leads us into: moral, financial, and spiritual. First, the moral hazard. The desire for money is a powerful temptation that seduces us to behave unethically or even illegally. When I first started out on my legal training at a law firm with a few of my classmates, one of the first tasks we were assigned to do was to oversee the move of the law firm's office to another location. The move lasted until about 3 a.m. in the morning. After it was finished, I was stunned when my classmate wanted us to share a cab home and then have each one of us make a separate claim for reimbursement. As someone has said, education does not reform a crook, it just makes him a smarter crook. Love of money is a dangerous trap. Second, the financial hazard. One of the common complaints I read on the internet is that the government does not let you take out all your CPF money when you reach 55. It's our money! Why can't we be trusted to manage on our own? Because the government understands the truth that the Bible teaches in this passage. The love of money often drives people to take foolish and harmful risks that plunge them into financial ruin and destruction. Third, the spiritual hazard. It's the same back in Paul's day as in ours. He said that many people who are eager for money have left the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. It's not just that people neglect God, have no time for church because they are so busy working and making money. Jesus taught us that money, more than anything else, has the power to set itself up as a competing God in our hearts. Those who love money invariably end up worshipping money and becoming enslaved by it. Paul uses an imagery that describes the high cost of acquiring money at the expense of our faith. It's like piercing our souls repeatedly with a knife. You might remember that when the government first announced the COVID-19 control measures effectively requiring everyone except those performing essential services to stay home, I made my first video recording and I spoke about how Israel had failed to let the land rest 1 year out of 7 as required by God's law. One of the reasons why God allowed them eventually to be conquered and taken away into exile was to let the land rest for the 70 years that they worked the land when they were not supposed to do so. One of the main reasons why God instituted the Sabbath day and the Sabbath year for the Israelites was to teach that we must take deliberate steps to hold greed in check. And since they did not learn it the easy way, they had to learn it the hard way by being taken captive. I feel that in a sense, we are experiencing our own captivity. And part of God's purpose for us in all this is to enforce the rest from work that many of us have failed to take for far too long. We are under house arrest during this period, effectively, unable to go do our work the usual way. Of course, we still try to do our work from home, and some of us actually end up working even harder, which is telling. We simply cannot stop working. Now that we can work anywhere, we work everywhere. And since we can work anytime, we work all the time. We really need to repent of our overwork and our acquisitive spirit and our love for money. We've been reading lots of reports about how nature is beginning to show signs of recovery because of reduced human traffic and activity. Air pollution is falling. The blue skies are coming back. Flamingos and dolphins are returning to places they have not been sighted in living memory. Even here in Singapore, I read in the papers that the grass is growing tall and wildflowers are blooming. This period is a small reset for nature, but let's make it a time for us to reset our souls as well. Even as we are forced to slow down drastically, let's take time to re-examine our heart's desires. Let's ask ourselves, to what extent have our lives been controlled and shaped by our love of money which drives us to work so hard? Driven by the love for the sense of self-esteem, security, prestige, perks, and popularity that we hope money will be able to buy us. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. May God protect us all from it. Let's look to Him for help. Father in heaven, I thank you for your warning in your word that tells us what the world convinces us is true is actually bad for us. Help us, Lord, to understand that while money itself is not a bad thing, the love of money leads us into all kinds of problems. Free our hearts, Lord, from the love of money. Help us to understand, Lord, that when we love money, we put ourselves in danger, financial danger, moral danger, and spiritual danger. Protect us, Lord, from every scheme of the evil one to try to use money to trap us and to trick us. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name we pray all this. Amen. Thank you for joining me for morning devotions. I'll see you again tomorrow morning at the same time. Till then, God bless you and have a great day.